Good afternoon and welcome, everyone. This afternoon's program is called The Art of Eating Salmon with Peter Johnsen, sponsored by the Lyceum at Sawyer Free Library. To give a brief introduction about Peter, Peter Johnsen was born in New Jersey but grew up in Norway, where he completed a Master's of Science in Ecology from the University of Bergen. His first work as a biologist in Norway was to study the impacts of fish farming on wild Atlantic salmon runs. Since moving to the US, he has worked with recovery of endangered and threatened Pacific salmon and steelhead populations in the West Coast. Through his work, he got interested in the diversity of salmon fishes, and he wants others to be as excited about these fish as he is. Currently, he works for the NOAA Fisheries in Gloucester, where he mostly works on reducing human impacts on endangered sturgeon. Peter's presentation is unrelated to his work at the agency, and any opinions expressed are his own. So we're so pleased to welcome Peter this afternoon, and I'm going to now hand the mic over to him.
Hey, thank you very much. I am, as I said, Peter Johnsen, and I'm going to give a presentation about salmon, and especially salmon as we use it for food. So I'm going to start a little bit with a PowerPoint in a few seconds, but first I want to just say that we all probably have eaten salmon and know what salmon is, we believe. The truth is there's a lot of different species of salmon and a lot of variation, which makes it very exciting as a food source for cooking, because each species have their different variation in taste and consistency. But I was going to start a little bit introduction with where I come from, what a project that I have been working on. And if you just give me 1 second here, I'll get my PowerPoint up and running and share that with you. And so again, give me 1 second here. Make sure everything works properly. And here we go. So this whole Zoom thing, it's kind of exciting, but also I'm not that used to it. So I'm going to share it here, and hopefully this will work. So the whole thing come about with a project that started several years ago called the Great Salmon Tour. And as was mentioned, I worked with Atlantic salmon studies in Norway several years ago, just after I finished my degree at the University of Bergen, and then moved to the US, to California, where I worked with recovery of Pacific salmon. And through that work, and I got to learn about the many different kinds of salmon that we have in the Pacific. And I was mostly used to Atlantic salmon, so I was very excited about this diversity. It wasn't really, well, I guess I was aware of it, but didn't really have made that page that much attention. And I found out I wanted to learn more about the diversity within this family of fishes called salmon or salmonids. And basically I, was adventurous and thought maybe I should try to see them all, many of them. And as I did so, I also found out that there's not only a diversity in within the salmon fishes, but there is also a diversity in human cultures connected to salmon. And I thought that was as much an interesting and important story as the diversity of salmon itself. So that's why I started the Great Salmon Tour, which was basically to try to cover it. And as a spin-off to that, I I'm going to see if this works, and it didn't. So I have to stop sharing and start a new. Let me see here. So if you just give me 1 second here, I have to share that one, share. Okay, no, I guess I have to share. I am not sure why, and then start here. I hope. Does this work? No. Okay, there we go. There's a little bit about the Great Salmon Tour. I traveled around actually several places around in the world, not only here in the US, to try to cover salmon and the cultural connections that people have of that. And the idea is to increase awareness of the nexus between cultural and biodiversity, as I believe that is a very important part was to be able to conserve and protect these species, which are often endangered and threatened in many places. But, you know, as part of a culture, eating is a big part of that. And therefore, I have decided to try to talk a little bit of salmon as a food, how we use it. So therefore, we have the art of eating salmon. It's adventure into taste and consistency. And the main reason I want to talk about that is because many of us think we know salmon. We buy it in the store, but most of the salmon we buy is farm-raised Atlantic salmon. And while salmon originally was the king of fishes, a very sought after fish, and mostly the rich and famous people were able to have it, local communities or landowners, kind of monopolized the fishing rights to the rivers. And so it wasn't like a common food for everyone. With the aquaculture and fish farming, however, it's now become something you can buy anywhere and everywhere all over the world in the grocery store. And while maybe some think it's expensive, but it's relatively cheap fish. So the thing with the aquaculture farm salmon is that it has made salmon into like one thing. They homogenize this great resource. To the extent that, when you go to a restaurant, look at the menu, it just says salmon on it. That despite that, just here in the US, in North America alone, we have six different species of salmon, and they all have their own taste and consistency of the flesh. We have the five Pacific salmon, which goes from California to Alaska. They're spread through there, and the Atlantic salmon, which we find here in the US on the East Coast and in Europe. However, like I said, many of these species and population of these species are highly depleted. And so there's very limited commercial fisheries for them, Atlantic salmon especially, has absolutely no commercial fisheries. It's all aquaculture. And so any Atlantic salmon you will buy in the store would be fish farmed. However, the Pacific salmon, the five Pacific salmons, they're still relatively sustainable runs up in Alaska. We do have a commercial fisheries for that, and you can actually buy wild salmon. And I want to put a little bit of attention to the variation that we have and how exciting that could be in eating. You don't have this one thing that you need to eat. It can, of course, be honest, just eating farm salmon can be kind of boring, the Atlantic salmon. So why not adventure into, a little bit other species and get a little bit different kind of tastes and things like that. The important part of understanding, salmon as food, the art of eating salmon, is that you have to understand the biology. If you do understand the biology, you will understand so much better how to use salmon, the differences, what's fresh, all the variation that is. And I'm going to talk about the variation because it's more than just species. So first, before we start talking about salmon, though, also a question, what is a salmon anyway? Because, we say we have the five Pacific salmon and we have Atlantic salmon, which is kind of the original salmon. There's even some dispute if Atlantic salmon even is a salmon for some in the Pacific. Well, those in the Atlantic would say the Pacific salmon might not actually be salmon. Well, the truth, let's start a little bit with what we call the five species, or the species of what we call salmon, belong to the family Salmonids, which is a family of species, salmon, which is this cold water fish. They're all in need and require cold water streams, fresh oxygenated cold water streams. So, and they're all endemic to the Nordic hemisphere. So you wouldn't find any natural native salmon species of any kind, in Australia or New Zealand or on the southern hemisphere. And that red line you can see there kind of approximately show where you can find different species of within the family salmonids, the salmon family. And I'll go. And so all species are cold water fish. And just to show a little bit of the great variation and diversity you have, you know, and the potential food experience you could have if you really dipped into this, I'm going to show you, because they're also beautiful fish and there's great variation. So I'm just going to very, very quick give you a little taste of that variation. Here, this is something called grayling. It's part of the salmon family, beautiful fish. This is, I believe, a lake trout or a bull trout. I can't really see right now, but either way, they are char, they're not actually trout. Here we have cutthroat trout, which is part of the Pacific salmon family or group. These ones, I believe, are a brown trout. Here, this is not a small cutthroat trout fished by me, actually. Let's see, little thing. This is a rainbow trout. Yeah, we have another, this is golden trout, belong, you know, a subspecies of rainbow trout found in California. This is the lake trout. Here we have another, actually the fish that inspired my great salmon tour is a totally different genus called Hutcho. And there's five species within that Hutcho. This is Hutcho. And you have maybe the most famous one, Hutcho taiman, you find in Mongolia. And as part of the Great Salmon Tour, I went to Mongolia to see that fish, which is another story. But they can be very, very large, up to 2 meters taiman, that is. This is a Hutcho. Here, this is, I believe, a brook trout. This is another part, a lesser known part of the salmon family, which also is very, very sought after when it comes to eating in many places of the world. It's the whitefish. Whitefish is part of the salmon family and is a delicacy in some parts of the world, especially Russia. This is a steelhead, which is the anadromous part of the rainbow trout. So they're same species, but a different life history. So a little bit of variation. Here we have another whitefish. This is the Hutcho taiman I talked about, found in Mongolia. This is from Mongolia. See, they can be quite large. That even though they do not go to the sea, they remain in large river their whole life. And I'm going to talk a little bit about life history of fish, because that is an important part of understanding how the different species taste and you know, using them as food. If you understand, you know, a little bit of biology, you can also understand a little bit, you know, the quality and taste and consistency of the different species. And this is a funny little one that's found in Bosnia and Herzegovina that I went to, called softmouth trout. It belongs to same genera as genus as brown trout. So this is a lake trout, and here we have one of the officially named salmon species. This is sockeye salmon. And just to tell you a little bit of different, you know, to what, you know, life history of salmon, which I think is important as we go into understanding, you know, the quality of the different of fish, because we also talked a little bit about how life history and when you catch them and things like that, how that actually affect their quality, like fat content and such. So we have, for what we, you know, all the salmon species and many, many of the other species, where they're called trout or char or whatever, is what's called anadromous life cycle. That is, they spawn and lay their eggs in the rivers or in lakes, like for sockeye, where the eggs will hatch and the small comes out. And all depending on difference of the species, they have different life stages. Some of the small one will stay in the river for a year, maybe up to 2 years. Other ones start moving towards the ocean immediately. But anyway, either way, whether they immediately start moving or they stay for a couple of years, they're eventually going to move downstream and into the marine environment. And that process, when they move, is called the smoltification. That is when the fish prepare themselves to go from fresh water to marine or salty water, which is obviously a lot of stress to the fish and changes the whole physiology. So they have to be prepared for that. They then move into the ocean, and again, depending on what kind of species, they will stay there from anything from 1 year, 2 years, or up to 5-6 years, all depending on the species. And they all, some will stay along the coast, and some will far away into the deep oceans and travel quite far. And obviously the other life cycle is the other fish, you know, the river part is the same, except the adults will never leave to go to the marine environment and stay, whether it's a lake or river or creek, but they will stay in freshwater their whole life. Like I said, all salmon more or less are anadromous. There are some landlocked salmon that use lakes as kind of the ocean instead of the ocean. What we often call trout or char, they might have either. They have some populations that stay in freshwater their whole life, and other populations of other fish that are anadromous and move into the ocean. So I'm going to talk a little bit. So there was, you know, a little bit about the variation we have. So I'm going to try to talk a little bit more about more the common fish that are more likely to end up on your dinner plate. And as I said, Atlantic salmon is maybe the most famous and the most, you know, like king of original salmon, if you want. Obviously, salmon is a word that comes from Europe and was transferred to US. And as they saw fish that had somewhat similar look and similar life cycle, were anadromous, they called salmon. So like the Pacific salmons, which I will mention, they put salmon in their name. Well, Atlantic salmon is a beautiful fish, can be quite large, just because that's one of the benefits of going to the ocean, where they then can eat on marine food, crustaceans or other fish or whatever, and they can grow to substantial size and be big. The fish has a beautiful meat. It's very flaky. It's flaky, has a relatively high oil content, which is important. Oil is the same as omega-3. So they are very nutritious. They are pretty long and stream-formed as fish. The thing is, though, like I said, you are hard to find any Atlantic salmon that comes from the wild in any grocery store. They will all be aquaculture or farmed or raised today. There are some places in the world, you can go to Spain, some places in Norway where you can fish for them, and you might be able to keep the fish and actually get wild Atlantic salmon. But for most of us, we have to do with the farm. And because they are farmed and they're fed and they don't be able to swim very much and just go round and round in the net pen, they get fat and they're full of fat oil. So on one hand, you might have something to say about farmed fish, but on the other hand, you do get the benefit of high oil content, in other words, high content of omega-3, which, you know, is very beneficial for you in many ways. And then we have what we call the Pacific salmon, and maybe the most famous of those is the Chinook salmon. Chinook salmon is also gets very large. It's the largest of the Pacific salmon. They spawn in large rivers from California up to Alaska, and they also spread over to Japan and Russia in the Pacific. They are have a orange, nice color to their flesh. Have relatively high content of oil, and it all also depending on where you fish them and what they eat, and you know, a lot of different life histories, but in general they have a high oil content. They will stay 2 to 5 years in the ocean, and the color of the flesh has been called coral, or but I would say more orange, and it breaks into large flakes. It's a very nice fish to have. The next one of the Pacific salmon to present is the sockeye salmon. Sockeye salmon is also quite common. You can find it in the grocery stores, actually more often than Chinook salmon. Chinook salmon is also definitely the most expensive of these. So your next is sockeye salmon. And it's not that flaky in the flesh. It has a much more reddish color of the flesh, a little bit less oil content. It's beautiful on the grill, And it's smoked. It's also commonly smoked. So when you go and get smoked salmon, you will, of course, aquaculture and the large extent is Atlantic salmon, you know, that's the most common one. But it's not uncommon to find sockeye salmon too, where you have subsistence fisheries, and which is common for Chinook salmon. It is commonly smoked there too, but I haven't actually that been able to find smoked Chinook salmon in your regular grocery store. But sockeye salmon you can find. It has a red beautiful color, but it's not that flaky. We'll see when you, if you buy smoked salmon or buy any of them to cook them, like Atlantic salmon will flake up beautifully, or sockeye salmon has less flaky fish, but and has a different taste, but it's a good taste to it. The next fish that we have is coho salmon, preferred by many over actually Chinook. It has a much milder taste. It's also Pacific salmon, so it's found, and it's also found from California to up to Alaska. It's a little bit shorter time in the ocean, which affects its the flesh of it. It's somewhat flaky, but and it's spawned in smaller streams and tributaries of tributaries to large rivers. It's a little bit about the biology. And they can be from 4 to 12 pounds, as compared to and Chinook salmons can be up to 11 to 30 pounds commonly, and even gotten supposedly, I think the record was 129 pounds for Chinook. So coho is a smaller fish, sockeye also, maybe more like a sockeye. The flesh is pinkish flesh that is lighter in taste than sockeye salmon, but and is somewhat firmer than Chinook. Many people prefer it because of these characteristics. So what I'm getting in here is you have all these different fishes and you can get different experiences. And it's a travesty that, you know, when you go to the restaurant, they just say salmon. Always, of course, Atlantic salmon, but it would be, you know, if they could start to have the more variation in there. Flesh, or in what they prefer, and what they cook. Coho salmon, I haven't really seen that smoked because it has somewhat lower oil content. Oh, did I go too far? Or did I? So that was the coho. No, shum salmon. See the coho. Then we have shum salmon. Shum salmon is a common fish. If you go up to Alaska, I mean, you know, they are fished for and smoked and kept there also for subsistence fisheries. However, they have different runs. And I went up to the Yukon River and they have different runs that make differences in the fish. And I will go talk a little bit about a little bit more in specific how biology affects. So this now I'm just going on general about the species and what they are and what they mean. But there is within each species a lot of variation in the quality, things like that. Again, shum is southernmost distribution is Oregon and goes up there, but Alaska is where you can't find them. They often typically spawn in lowermost reaches of large rivers and streams, but they can go farther upstream, which is a point I will bring up later on. And they might average about around 10 pounds. And they're kind of the least expensive, but you also don't often find them in the grocery store, but they are the least expensive because they have lighter color of the flesh than it's, you know, doesn't have that vibrant color that you like to have a salmon. They have a coarse flesh and they're also less flavorful, something. However, a lot of people really love it. They also have less oil than other variety or other species. And therefore are not that often, it's not, you know, commercially or commonly found as a smoked salmon compared to, like, for instance, sockeye, which almost have a higher oil content. And then the last of our Pacific salmon is pink salmon, also called humpback salmon. And that's the ones you might see in pictures from Alaska or up there where you're just like choke full of salmon coming up. They spawn in the lower reaches, like pretty close to the ocean. And they also, this is the once the fry comes out of the gravel, because they put all these salmon species put their eggs in the gravel where they incubate. And once they come out of the gravel, they move more or less directly towards the ocean and into marine waters. They are smaller, they're pink. You mostly will find them as canned salmon. When you have canned salmon, it most cases are pink, sometimes shrimp. Not often you find them, not that commonly found in the store as, you know, as salmon, sold as salmon or on the restaurant menu. They have a fine texture of the meat and range in color from light to deep pink. And they're not smoked either because they have very little oil in the meat. They are interesting because they stay in the river, no, in the ocean for 2 years. So you have the odd and even years, and say like because they, you know, they go directly into the ocean as soon as they, more or less as soon as they emerge from the gravel. And those 2 years of the run are reproductive isolated from each other because they stick to these 2 years. While most of the other salmon can vary, some of the individuals might stay 1 year, some might 2 years, some might 3 years. You get an overlap between the different generations, not so with pink. So often, and the odd year is the abundant one, while the even numbered years has much smaller populations. So if you're going to go fish for them, you go for an odd numbered years to try to get or see the large, large runs of pink or humpback salmon. Another interesting fact about humpback salmon or pink salmon is that they're found to be quite adaptable. The Russian released them in rivers on it won't be Atlantic side, but in the Arctic, and they managed to make their way down through Norway and even into UK. And the question is, what does that mean for the few Atlantic, like say Atlantic runs almost all over the world are depleted. And having another new introduced species coming in and potentially competing with the native Atlantic salmon runs could be a threat to Atlantic salmon. But like I said, they have a very, very different life cycle. They spawn in the lower part, not far up from the estuary of the rivers. So while Atlantic salmon will move far up into the rivers where they spawn high up in the watershed. So whether or not they're going to end up being a competition or not is a question. There's also been some reports of pink salmon coming down here on the east coast of Canada. And so see what that means for our very, very depleted Atlantic salmon run, which ran from Hudson River north through Canada, but now today only exists in rivers in Maine. So that was the salmon. And now I can just quickly talk a little bit what a salmon is. Well, we have the salmon and you have trout and you have char and whitefish and mentioned hutchel. So the thing is, there really isn't anything like salmon. Salmon is just a name you put on some of these fish that have certain characteristics. They are anadromous, they get big, but there's a lot of anadromous salmonids that we don't call salmon, but a char and trout that runs into the river. Many of these, like the hutchel taimony, so it gets really, really big, even though it's not anadromous. And it's not the characteristics of salmon. You can say, oh, big salmonids are salmon and small are trout or char. That's not correct. It's not a taxonomic group because the Pacific salmon is a totally different genus than Atlantic salmon. And hutchel taimon is usually commonly called taimon salmon, even though it's neither anadromous nor, it's not anadromous and don't belong to the same genus as Atlantic salmon or Pacific salmon. It's totally different. It's the hutchel genus. So really there's, while we have salmon and same with trout. Trout is all over the place too when it comes to in taxonomy. And you have trout that anadromous, trout that's not anadromous. You have some that big, some that doesn't get big. So therefore, when I talk about us understanding and liking and trying to appreciate salmon as food, I don't only talk about those that officially are salmon in the name. I include trout, char, whitefish. If you ever get the chance to eat the hutshuk, you're welcome. So to be able to really experience, understand, and be there, I'm gonna call it a salmon aficionado, we have to expand ourselves and say there's actually 200 species of different salmonids. So, you know, potentially a huge variation to pick from and enjoy. So I'm gonna go on to some other species that do not have officially salmon in their name, but belong to the salmon family of fishes. And, you know, we could, some places in the world, you'd call any kind of salmonid for salmon, which could be as right as anything. And one of those beautiful and really tasty is Arctic char, as the name implies. It's found in the Arctic. It's actually circumpolar, so it's found in, you know, in northern Norway and Russia, it's even in the UK and Canada. However, not in the US, except from a small rest, or a lot of 48 states, that is, except from one remnant population from the last ice age that exists in Maine, US. Arctic char has also two life forms. You can, those that don't go in the ocean, you know, anadromous form. So, you know, we can get them as freshwater fish, and you can get them as big sea-going fish. Because of that and what they eat, they vary. Some of them can have pretty white meat, while others can have pinkish, delicate colors. They are also a very mild fish. A lot of people like it, and you can get that. They do get farmed. There are aquaculture for them. Indigenous tribes up in Canada have aquaculture. It's an important part of their culture, and they also, you know, get some economic benefits from it. Like I said, the flesh is from pink to red, and it also has a very high oil or fat content. So it is good for smoking, so you can find it smoking. It's also excellent on the grill, and you can even make sushi out of them. They say that the taste is almost creamy. It's a milder salmon taste to it. I found it in, you know, local grocery stores, farm though. Or you can go, like many of these fishes, go for a fishing trip. Go and fish them yourself. And then maybe the one that people have heard about, rainbow trout. Rainbow trout is common. It's also belong to Pacific. However, been stocked not only everywhere here in the US, but all over the world. One of the special things about rainbow trout is it also has two different life stages. Whereas you have the freshwater, and then you have what's called steelhead, which is the same species, but the anadromous life form of it. Rainbow trout, because the rainbow trout is the freshwater part, the ones that do not go in the fish, you know, they become more pan-sized fish. They are usually white in the meat, but they can also have some coloration in them, again, depending on what they eat, which I'm going to talk about a little bit more. The meat is mild and has a delicate nut-like flavor. And of course, you can buy them in the store as farm raised, and put them in the frying pan. The flesh is tender and flaky and soft, and it could be anything from white, but it can also be pink or orange, depending, especially, if you catch them wild, and depends on what they eat. And then if you have them farm raised, they do, some do add coloration to, you know, artificially art coloration to the food, actually, some chemicals to the food that makes the flesh having color. And when it's cooked, it's a delicate flaky and have a color paleness to it. Like I said, we have steelhead, which is the anadromous part. It's somewhere in between salmon and trout, maybe in taste. It also has a pinkish color. It is, we do have farm rate. Steelhead means rainbow trout that's been raised in the ocean to let grow to larger size. Also good on the grill, as the medium fat oil content. It's also a good fish, and you can fish go fish for them, and you can get them as aquaculture, get them in the store. The next one I call brown trout. Brown trout is now, we are now on the other side, and that's not found here in the US. You find it in Europe. Brown trout is however common throughout Europe. You find them even they say there's some populations in Morocco and high in the mountains in Morocco. You find them, the Bosnia Herzegovina over there in different forms and shapes. Some, they say there's some in Tigris River, which is gone into a separate species because they've been isolated from the rest of the population for a long time. And there's a special story that can be told another time why they're in the Tigris River, which drains not into the Mediterranean, but the other way. So it shouldn't really be any salmonids there, but that has to do with tectonic shifts. And they got isolated in there. Anyway, has somewhat more oily taste to it. Some people are not that happy with, a lot of people are very happy with brown trout, but it has a high oil content and has been known to have a stronger flavor, more fish flavor, especially the larger brown trouts. And the fishy taste can put off some people from it. To get over that a little bit, some chefs say you can have them in milk overnight, which take away some of that fishy, oily flavor. However, they beautiful. I had brown trout, tastes absolutely delicious, pan fried. Obviously, it's a very popular fish to fish for. Also, Europeans looked at them as something special, maybe next after the Atlantic salmon, and they brought them with them, and they have been stocked, and they're stocked today here in the US and throughout the world, actually. It's a popular thing to fish for, and it's stocked many streams all over here in the US, which is kind of unfortunate. I am not a big fan of stocking non-native fish into streams. Especially if they take and start reproducing, building up their population and compete with native fish. And here on the East Coast, well, native fish is brook trout. I'm going to mention them soon, but that has been a problem. Well, talking about brook trout, I'm going to brown trout a little bit, but like I say, there's also ocean going anadromous part of it, which is gets much, much bigger. And it's also, gets more salmon kind of taste to it, more Atlantic salmon, also very popular fish. And brown trout is also commonly farmed for it. It's farmed all over. It's not so much here in the US. And I haven't really seen that much of them in the market, but if you go to Europe, you find brown trout. All over, because it's commonly farmed for, especially having the aquaculture in sea and having them as the anadromous form, the much larger form. And then brook trout, it's not, as far as I know, commercially fished for or even aquaculture for it, so you can't find it in stores. Obviously, popular fish to fish for. Most of it is catch and release. It's as a fish native to the East Coast, the only salmonid native to the East Coast. It's dear and near to many people. So mostly it's a catch and release, but some places you can actually put them on the frying pan and eat them. Their meat is light and delicate and has almost sweet flavor when compared with flesh of other trout. Supposedly it's best eaten if you catch them in spring or summer. But to fish for them yourself, as far as I know, you wouldn't be able to buy them in the store. So that was, I just want to go a little bit. See, did I have a picture of that? So there's a lake trout, another one. There's also absolutely beautiful fish when you get it. If you go out and fish for them and catch them, they're absolutely beautiful fish, the brook trout. And by the way, they're not trout, they're char. Talking about, trout isn't really a taxonomic or really a real thing either. But so I hope I didn't bore you. I hope rather I introduced you to some of the excitement, what you can experience. You know, my vision is that you go to a restaurant and instead of just having salmon on the menu, they would say, okay, what, sir, what would you have? Would you like to have a steelhead, a chinook, or maybe I can, emphasize you with Arctic char, and you have something to choose from. And I, you know, many of these, you can actually get many of these different ones in the store, and you can have a big party at home, and you can have the different fish, prepare them different ways, and, you know, serve that to your friends and family, and, you know, and you can take and brag a little bit about your knowledge about them and how you cook them. See. So that was a little bit about all the, you know, some of them, like I say, some fish, you have 200 different species to talk about, to choose among. Where were we? In my thing here. Okay, let's go back to next one. Slide. See if this is going to work still. Yeah. So, like I say, if you're really going to understand, how to use and you know what these different fish are and how they are as food, you really have to understand the biology. And I was going to start with, but I'm going to take and compare fish a little bit with wine. You have different kind of wines depending on grapes. So you have different grapes, maybe Chardonnay. I am not a big wine person, but you know, Chardonnay, Merlot, Pinot Noir, whatever. Different grapes makes different kind of wines. Similar with salmon, you have different species. It's different taste, different characteristics of the flesh. And then with wine, you don't only have the different type of grapes, but then you have where they're grown, what kind of climate, what kind of soil, what valley, what country for that matter, makes difference. Someone that really knows wine can sip a Chardonnay and say like, oh, that comes from so-and-so place with that kind of climate and soil. Oh, sip another one. Oh, that comes from that and that place with so-and-so soil. So it makes difference. Same with salmon. It's not only the different species, but where the salmon are come from. Like salmon, chinook from California and chinook from Alaska might have different characteristics when it comes to using them as food, as taste, as the quality of their meat and the coloration and everything like that. And there's also differences within. What you have a species, you have other, like you have different, what you call runs, which I'm going to talk a little bit about. And I think I'm going to have some slides after this. Actually, I'm going to see if I can. And that all these differences, it all comes down to the biology of the fish. So all these differences give you a lot of opportunity difference in how to use them and how to eat them. And just to give you just one little side of this, like here you have a shum salmon. And like I said, it's not only maybe as on the grapes too, when you pick them, right? If you're early or late or whenever with different characteristics of the wine. For shum salmon, you have where you take and catch the fish fire. So in the upper picture is a shum caught in the sea. It's silvery, very fresh. The one in the middle is once they're on the spawning, when they move in and they're into the spawning ground and they get their spawning colors. This is so they are now ready to spawn. And the lower picture is obviously a fish you don't want to eat. This is not necessarily dead. Once they start spawning and get out of the spawning grounds, they start to deteriorate because they're gonna, for the things that happen is once their whole, this special about the Pacific salmon is that they die after they spawn. They only spawn once. Atlantic salmon, on the other hand, kind of go spawn, survive, go back into ocean, be in the ocean, fatten up again, and come back into the river, spawn multiple times. All the Pacific salmon, they only spawn once. And once they get up to the spawning ground, they're going to use all their resources into one thing, and that is to spawn, to produce eggs, to lay eggs, and the males to fight each other and get access to females. And that, and expense of that is that their whole bodies deteriorate. They're actually using up their body to put it into reproduction. So the immune system collapses, their whole thing collapses, and they get, as you can see in that picture, you get fungus growing on them, the meat gets almost mushy, and they're basically not useful for any kind of food consumption for humans. Now, there's a difference. When you go up the Yukon River, you will hear about dog salmon. And many people think dog salmon is the same as shum, just not a name for it, because it's fed to the dogs. They feed shum to the dogs. But that's not true, because there's two different runs of shum salmon. And one of the runs comes in a little bit earlier in the summer and spawn relatively low in the Yukon River. So when they get to the river, when they start moving upstream, and as not get very far, they start to change into the spawning colors, they start to get ready to spawn, their meat start to deteriorate, and then, you know, getting closer to the lower picture there. And obviously they're not very good for human food. So, but they're caught. And the communities along the Yukon River will catch these early run shum, and they will dry them, and they will use them for dog food. So, dogfish, dog salmon. However, later in the fall, another run of shum salmon, the same species, comes in, and they go much farther up in the Yukon River and spawn much farther up. So when they enter the river, and as they move upward, they still have their silvery color, more their silvery color. They haven't gone into full spawning colors, full spawning, ready to spawn. So, you know, when they come up to, like, I went some distance up in the Yukon River to a village called Tanana River. Once they get there, that fall run is still useful. It's still caught and used for human consumption. It's caught, it's dried, it's smoked. So as you see, it's the biology of these also determines where and when you fish it. But in general, just in general, because the whole purpose of the salmon is to spawn. It wants to produce as many eggs as possible, and the males want to mate with as many females as possible. So they have to be big, they have to be strong, and they have to have resources. And resources is oil, and you want salmon that has as much oil and fat content as possible to get the best meat possible. So therefore, most of the salmon, the salmon that you buy in the store that's wild caught, is caught to ocean fisheries, but that's not necessarily the best salmon. There are, but it's because when they enter the river, that's when they have the maximum oil and fat content, because then they have built that up through all, they might not have finished building up, they're still growing maybe when they're in the ocean. So they still have to put resources into growth. But at the point when they eat it, when they hit the river, they are in their maximum. That's actually when, if you're going to have really high quality salmon fish, flesh, you want to get those that caught at the mouth of the river and earth, like low down the river, and obviously before they start getting ready to spawn and turn. So, and there's a few smaller local community fisheries that target those things. And if you go and you can get them online, or you can try to find those, that would be the best salmon that you can have when it comes to their meat. So that was a little bit about I'm going to go back because I'm not finished talking, and rather I'm going to let you watch me a little bit. I'm going to stop sharing here. So there's other things to consider when it comes to biology and when it comes to the fish. Like I said, the life histories, you have the basic two life is anadromous, whereas from those that are resistant to staying freshwater throughout their life. And the main thing that goes with those two differences is size and also taste. Obviously, when you go to the marine environment, you're going to get a different consistent taste of the fresh compared to a fish that stayed in freshwater all its size. Doesn't mean that one is better than another. It's just two different experiences when it comes to eat them. And obviously, nothing is better than a pan-fried trout, and different trout has different flavors. You have a brook trout, you have a brown trout, or you have a rainbow trout, or any of the other resident fish, or lake trout, or Arctic char. Lake trout is also char, by the way. Brook trout, they all have different flavors, but they all best put them in the pan with a lot of butter and frying them up. So they, you know, all, and maybe bread them and having the skin being all fried and crisp. There's also other things besides when to catch them. Different runs meaning what river they, when I say runs, this depends, you know, what run they're going into and where in the river they go. What river they go to for the salmon, those that are anadromous, would determine what they look and muscle structure and things like that. So if you have a river that is relatively flat when it comes to, you know, not going up to high altitudes, you will get fish that are longinated, that, you know, have stamina to really swim long distances, maybe against the current and things like that. Their muscle structure might be different. They have more longinated fibers and things like that. And their body would be long instead of deep, meaning, you know, so that, well, however, a salmon or a trout for that matter, that returns to an area where they're going to have to climb up altitude to get to their spawning areas. They need to burst. They need that power to go in, to jump over, you know, you all seen the pictures of the jumping salmon, right? So they're going to be shorter and deeper. They're going to need to have, and their muscle fiber is going to be different and more compact. And that will be, so you know, you also, if you really want to go into it, you will look at, you know, where the runs, what does the rivers look like and where they're caught, because that will have some say of what the flesh taste on looks like. And then, of course, coloration also comes down to biology. It's all down to biology, because the pinkish color, the coloration that you find in the fish, whether you have white or really like the sockeye that's bright red, or the more pinkish, light pinkish or coho, also some like trout, some are white, some have some pinkish color. It comes down to what they eat. And that coloration of pinkish or red or orange coloration comes from pigments found in crustaceans. So if you have a population or a species that eats a lot of crustaceans, that means small shrimp, krill, things like that, that will give them the coloration, what we usually call salmon coloration, the pinkish, things like that. And you have, so often, you know, especially for trout, you have some populations that just eat mostly insects, they would be more yellowish in the coloration of the meat. With those that are in systems where you have more crustaceans, they will get that more pinkish color. And even for you know, the salmon that go, or the fish, the anadromous one that goes out in the ocean, they will gorge and go up on all kind of crustaceans out there. However, there's difference for chinook, which, you know, the most popular of all the Pacific salmon, one's most expensive, has more an orange and kind of light color to it. It's you know, beautiful coloration, what they call, you know, typical salmon color to it, maybe. There's also some runs that have white. They don't have that much coloration. It's because they mostly eat fish once they get in there. You can actually get chinook with white flesh. So, oh, again, you know, and it can be an interesting thing. If you want to serve, you have two chinook, one with white, one with the, you know, orange coloration. And you can look and see if the taste with different presentations on the table, obviously. So you have so many opportunities, different things. If you really go into it and start looking at it, you will find it you have an excitement of differences that you can do when it comes to cooking and gastronomics and all those kinds of things like that, and not to mention presentation of the fish. So I just want to, again, say, if you really want to learn about how to use this, you would like to go into, go and learn about biology and really understand the fish, where it comes from, where it was caught, what the river system is, what they eat, to really understand what you have on your table. And, kind of brag a little bit or impress your whoever is you have for your dinner. Or if I think actually be a great thing for restaurants, they should have, a small description of the fish and why they have it and what they've done with it and things like that. Have the different kinds of species, or maybe the same species, but from different places, different runs. And they could have little cards saying, this shinner comes from so-and-so, therefore it has this kind of, the meat is like this, has this coloration, or this shinner comes from that area, is caught at the mouth of river so-and-so, and therefore it has these, eat these kind of things, coloration, and, the meat is different and things like that. And the last part, I'm going to go back a little bit to my PowerPoint. If you bear with me a little bit. Okay, and see the bar down here. Well, I also going to mention one last thing about differences in thing, and that is it not only comes, so you have more things to consider when you eat salmon, because it doesn't only come down to the species or where it was caught, where it comes from, but the fish itself varies. The different part of the fish are different. One of the typical things is that the belly part has a lot of fat. It does not have much meat and muscles, but it has a lot of fat of it. That part in local communities that know about fish, they cut that part of the fish out and use that for other things. It's often used to can, because of the fat content makes a good as a canned fish. Or they even smoke that part of it, while the bigger and thicker part of the flesh is used to smoke or strip or other things like that. So it's not only feed, I'm going to go back to, so it's not only about, stop sharing, I'm not sharing, I'm not sharing. So it's not only about the species and fish, you have to look at the fish itself, and then of course you have big ones and small ones, they all need to be treated different. You have a big sockeye, a small sockeye, big shrimp, small shrimp, big trout, small trout, you can use those different when you're cooking, and use them for different things. Some ones fried on the pan, some might be used in a stew, some might be put in the oven, once roasted, put on the grill. It all depends on different things. Okay, now I think I'm going to go back to my PowerPoint. And okay, I hope everyone sees that. Okay, next. So now we talked about a little bit about the variation of fish, the fish you have. I'm just going to talk a little bit about the cooking and preparation of fish. As you know, salmon is delicious, we all like it, and there's all this different variation, and we do all kinds of things. There's sushi, they've got the pan fried, ovens cooked, smoked, rockfisk, grilled. There's many variations. So again, using my wine comparison, so you have grapes, you have where they're grown, and you have how they're prepared. One winery used the same grapes from the same place gets a different wine than another winery that has the same grapes on the same place. And the same thing with how you prepare them. And what's so special, the thing with salmon is that they are very, very, been a very, very important resource for local communities. And that's why there's so much cultural stuff and social importance to the salmon. They're not just food or some way of earning money, but where people and salmon or trout for that matter, and salmonids overlap, it also has created all these different connection and culture. And one of the things that is special, why salmon and trout has been so important, is because there are cold water fish in subarctic and arctic areas and temperate areas. They are the main fish species you find in freshwater areas. And they also are very seasonal. There's an abundance of them. There's a lot of them. But that abundance for many, especially for anadromous species, is seasonal. So suddenly you have all these fish, that enormous amount of important nutritious resource, but you can't eat it all at the same time. So you need to find ways to keep it for the rest of the winter and until next run. And obviously different cultures and different places solve that problem in many ways. Like I say, this menagerie is not only for humans, but even for other species. And actually, the Amanda's little side note, because they are so abundant, and especially seasonally abundant, come in, they are enormously important for the whole ecosystem and nutrition. They provide nutrition to not only the things that eats them, but also to plants and the whole algae and the insects that lives in the river and maintain nutrition to the river and even the terrestrial part of the upland areas. The bears and everything brings them up where they strand in and they lay down and they rot and they provide all these resources, especially for the Pacific salmon where they all die. And you know, like I say, there have been, because of the abundance, enormous importance for local communities. But because of abundance, they're also easy to catch and, you know, been there. But like I say, you have to find ways to deal with them, take care of that meat. Just kind of jump quickly over that. So it's video time, and I'm gonna show you a video a little bit about how to process salmon, how they do it in the New River, and I visited there. So I have to stop share and then reshare this thing. Okay, so give me a moment. And yeah, so this is I went up to Alaska to learn a little bit about, you know, communities there and what the salmon means for them, and how they prepare and take care of the fish. So I made a little just short video. I had one guy explain to me, you know, the whole process of salmon, once you catch them and what you do with them before you even start making them food out and processing them. And I'm lucky now, I can manage to share this one. And so this should take, I think it's 7 minutes or something, network. Reload the player. Okay, I'll reload the player. Okay, let's see if we can get this one running. I hope you enjoy.
Right. God, that is a nice
thing. That is a nice thing.
I only got 5 of those yesterday.
Depending on what we're going to do with the fish,
determines how you cut the head off. Then the bloodline comes out. Not always necessary, but it makes for a cleaner. It makes it cleaner on the table when you're filleting. If the bloodline comes out, then you fillet the little buggers. A long time ago, and really some people still do it today, but they would take, and they would take these backbones like this, and they would cut them like this so that the air got in to them and smoke them. And in the winter time, they would use them to make fish or soup. Hardly anybody does that anymore. Sometimes we take and we score them like this. All the pieces they can't touch. And then you take and you split it down like this. And you hang it like that.
Panty parade.
Look at, he's taking a movie of us. We're gonna be famous.
Yeah.
Last of the Mohegans. Hurry up. Get up. Here we cut this part off, which is the cheek and the collar. And that goes away. Then we take this butthole meat right here off. We'll take that part right there because it's got a lot of fat in there. And we'll mix it with the other flesh of the fish in the jar. It'll make it uniform after it's cooked. This is the belly here. And I take this off, this membrane off. And we're salting these now. We were scoring them and hanging them, but now we're
it's soft.
Well, which way am I going to do it? Kind of small. Strip it. And then we will take and strip the fish up until we get to the pin bones that run right around in here. Sometimes I will strip that pin bone and we salt it and brine it and hang it on a different pulp bones. So we jar that. What else can I say?
And the strips are either smoked or dried or both.
Smoked and dried. Some people don't smoke them. Some people leave them outside. And they call them sun dry. And I kind of prefer mine that way. I don't like to put too much smoke on mine. I don't like it where you get cotton mouth from too much smoke. But smoke in its own way, a peculiar way, and I'm not sure how, is some sort of a preservative as well as the salt. Mm-hmm. But when the chums come, we don't put hardly any salt on them at all unless we're going to strip them. And that depends on the age of the fish that are coming back. Because if you get a lot of five or six year old chums that are coming back, they're big enough to strip. But most chums are small, and you have to, and we make dry fish out of them because it's too much work. You just have a short strip that's only maybe 14 inches long. See, contrary to your previous belief, we just don't hang around and drink beer all day.
So that was a little bit about how they do it in Alaska. And now I'm just gonna finish off here a little bit to talk about one thing that people ask me about, you know, how do you know if the salmon is fresh? And again, it comes down to biology. As I said, salmon are cold water fish. And it just kind of pertains to most fish because the most live in a very cold environment. But especially salmon, they're cold water fish, and all fish are not able to maintain a body temperature. They have the same temperature and environment around them. It means that they have the same temperature as the water that they are in. And because they do live in a very cold environment, the physical properties, how their body function, has to be able to work at low temperatures, which means that the oil and the fat in them has very low melting temperature and solubles. They maintain liquid even at relatively low temperatures. And also the enzymes in the fish obviously will have to work at low temperatures as compared to, for instance, us or the cow that goes out there in the field, other meat we eat, which maintain the enzymes specialized to work at much higher temperature, whatever the body temperature that animal maintains. And the same with the, you know, the fat and oil will have a totally different temperature where they get liquefied. So the consequences of that is that the oil in salmon it can oxidize at very low temperatures. So while you and the enzymes starts to break down the cell structure of the fish at relatively low temperatures compared to other. So when you take your steak, your Angus beef, and you want to keep it for a while, you put it in the fridge because the low temperatures to 70, it's or holds or minimize the activity of the enzymes. It maintains any fat as solids. And of course, bacteria that might be on that piece of fish is going to have a lot less activity. You take a salmon, put it into the fridge, same temperature, the enzymes will continue to work more or less. It's going to continue to break down the cell structure. The oil's still going to react with oxygen or with the air and oxidize and get harsh, and you get that smelly fish that what creates that smelly fish smell. And if you have bacteria from the fish that comes from the cold water, they're going to continue to be active too. So they have a much lower time that they can be maintained in the fridge compared to your regular beef or chicken. And if you're going to look and you go to, so when you go to the market, and so when you cut the fish, obviously, you're going to have this a new surface that where the oil can react with the oxygen. And with the enzymes exposed to high temperature, but especially the oil reacts. So really, if you're going to have a good fish fillet or a steak, the best way, now it's difficult, but the best way would be to somewhere they have the whole fish and you have them cut it for you right there and then there, instead of having some that's pre-cut and be laying in the counter for some time. Or even better, more is if you can bring the whole fish home and cut it up just before you're going to start to prepare it. When it comes to how to, so when you're going to look at the salmon in the counter, find out if it's fresh and good, you know, you want that skin to be glossy. You don't want it to be stretched, not dull and wrinkled. If it gets dry or wrinkled, it will become wrinkly and dry over time. So that's one way of seeing, especially if it's not properly covered with ice. However, you don't have to be concerned about the color. You know, all fish, they will lose the color pretty quickly after they've been killed. So coloration, loss of coloration might not necessarily mean that the fish is bad or being old. Another thing that you actually do want to do is that the slime, the mucus on the skin, you might want to actually keep that and that's in there, because it actually has some antibacterial properties. But it should be transparent, and because over time, the proteins in that mucus, they coagulate and take on a milky appearance. So it goes from, you know, off-white, yellowish to brown eventually if it gets really old, if you start to have that. So you definitely don't want to have it in that stage. So you want, you know, just mucus to be there, the skin to be stretched. You want the shiny and bright eyes, the eyes to go be comics and, you know, sink in, also go milky and dry up, and old fish, you definitely don't want that. And at least for sure, if the belly is, you want a fish where the belly is not swollen, because gut bacteria enzyme activity can eat through the gut and into the belly cavity and muscle, and that produce gases that will balloon the belly. So if you see anything, you know, with a balloon belly, you don't want to buy that fish, that's for sure. Once you get your fresh fish and you have it, and you're not going to cook it immediately, at most, the salmon shouldn't stay in the fridge for more than, you know, 2-3 days at the most. Because even if you have it in the cold environment of the fridge, it's still going to oxidize, or it's going to oxidize. Obviously, freezing fish helps and do that. That was a little bit about, again, comes down to biology, the whole thing, when it comes to understanding how to prepare fish and keeping it and doing things. So that was a little bit about the exciting, hopefully exciting, variety about fish, how to be a salmon connoisseur, if you want, aficionado. And I hope it's inspired you a little bit to go and try to explore more than your farm-raised Atlantic salmon. Go out there. You can't find them. You can't find variety. You can. Maybe you have to go to Whole Foods to get your Chinook. Maybe you have to go in the freezer to get your pink. You might find Arctic char. You have to go there several times. You might, and you find your sockeye. And then you have look for smoked salmon. But anyway, I hope it inspired you. I hope you enjoyed the talk. And I'll thank you very much for taking the time to listening to this. I know it's been long. And I appreciate that you hanged out so far. Thank you very much. Bye.